Okay, well, I'd like to welcome everyone to another Sunday service of Christ Reformed Church. I'm Pastor Ferguson, and it's great to be gathered together in the name of the Lord. Amen. You know, waiting is not something we enjoy doing always, but God has called us to wait upon Him. And that's what I'm going to be speaking about today, is waiting upon the Lord. The benefits of it, the blessings that come with it, and the curses or chastenings that come when you don't wait, when we don't wait, including myself, upon the Lord. It's a very important topic for the Christian. Christian life needs to be and is based upon waiting upon the Lord. We are waiting for provisions each day. We're waiting for our redemption, eternal life. We're waiting for heaven, and we're waiting for the new earth. We're waiting for a lot of things, and we need to train ourselves to learn how to wait, how to be patient, and wait patiently. I'm going to be coming to you from a few different scriptures out of Psalms and Job and Isaiah. But before I do, I'd like to invite you to join me in a word of prayer. Will you pray with me? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Father of lights, and Father of love, Father of every living thing, we just thank you and praise you for being our God and our Father. Lord, we ask you will forgive us of our sins, of being impatient, of not waiting upon you as your word commands us to do. Lord, we oftentimes take matters into our own hands, and we know that when we do this, the results are never going to be good. Lord, we've banged our head enough times, we're tired, and we pray, oh God, you'll teach us and instruct us how to wait upon you and receive the blessings that come with waiting. We just pray for all of our brothers and sisters in Christ, that you would strengthen our faith and trust in you and our obedience unto your holy and righteous word. Be with all your little children. Lord, protect them from all hurt, harm, and danger, from abortion and child abuse, molestation, and neglect, and malnourishment. Lord, we pray you would just protect them from these things, and you will open the minds of the hearts, minds and hearts of the moms and dads, doctors and nurses and lawmakers of their sins, of murder and abuse, and you will convict them. You will bring them to repentance. We just thank you and praise you for being our God, our Lord, our Master, our Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. So, what does it mean to wait upon the Lord? Well, I want to turn our attention, firstly, to Isaiah. Isaiah, I know you've probably heard this verse. I'm sure you've read it. If you've read the Bible at all, you've come across it. Isaiah was a great prophet of God, and God used him in a mighty way. And here we see in chapter 40, starting in verse 28 and reading through verse 31. And it says, "Hast thou not known, hast thou not heard, that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is weary? There is no searching of his understanding. He giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might he increaseth strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. So beginning in verse 28, there's a rhetorical question. Hast thou not known? Hast thou not heard that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not? In other words, God doesn't get tired. God never faints. God never gets weary. He is pure energy. He has all energy. He possesses all. He is the source of all energy. He is life. And in Him is no weakness, no sickness, no death, no disease, nothing of that nature. He is pure life. And here Isaiah is prompting this question, do you not know that the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, he fainteth not, neither is weary? He is the source of strength, of our strength especially. He gives strength even to the wicked of the world. He has to in order for them to survive. He gives breath to every living creature, the animals, the birds, you know, everything that breathes. God is the one who gives them the breath. And we need to take notice of that He is the source of strength. And we need to draw our strength from Him, especially in times of trial and temptation, when the passions or lust of the flesh are warring against our soul. We need to turn to God for strength, as Jesus did in the Garden of Gethsemane, and fell down on His face and prayed in great agony. It says He prayed more earnestly as the temptation increased. We need to be like that. We need to do that. Not cave in the moment we feel some impulse of the flesh. We shouldn't cave into that. We should run to God for strength. Corinthians says that no temptation has taken you but that which is common unto man. The only temptation that could take you is the one that you allow it to take you. The one that is common to man, well, man, without God, he cannot resist temptation. He can't overcome it because he does not have the Holy Spirit living in him. So he's going to succumb to every temptation of his flesh. But we have strength, we have power from God to resist. It says, neither is weary, there is no searching of his understanding. Now here in verse 29, it says, he giveth power to the faint. Just exactly what I was preaching about. Power to the faint. And to them that have no might, he increases strength. Once again, if you need strength, you feel weary and tired all the time, turn to God. He's the author of our strength, of our life. And He will strengthen us. Verse 30, even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. So even in the flower of life and youth, when you have all the energy that you would ever possibly need, you're still going to get tired. You're still going to faint if you overwork yourself, if you outdo yourself. But those of us who belong to the Lord, even in our older age, we can still maintain that strength. We can not be weary and not faint. Why? Because the Lord upholds us with His mighty right hand of power. And here's the pivotal or pinnacle verse of the chapter. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. So waiting upon the Lord In time of temptation, well, you have to get down on your knees and wait upon the Lord to deliver you from the passion of the flesh. In time of anger, get down on your knees and pray. Wait upon the Lord. Don't take matters into your own hands. That's not waiting upon the Lord. That's being impatient. I'm not waiting upon anybody. That's just doing what you think is right. There is a way that seems right unto man, but the end is death. You just do what you think is right. You go on. You're going to find out it was not the right choice. You should have waited upon the Lord. You should have kept your mouth sealed, zipped up, and waited upon the Lord before you speak and before you act. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. You know, wings as eagles. Well, you look at an eagle in the sky, he's not exerting a lot of strength. He just opens his wings and lets the wind carry him. He's mounted up. And that's what happens when you place your faith and trust in the Lord. Come unto me, all you weary and heavy laden. I will give you what? Rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn me. I am meek and lowly of heart. You shall find rest for your soul. Take my yoke upon you. My burden is light. My yoke is easy. My burden is light. The wings of eagles. Okay. When your heart is in submission to the Lord, then it's as if then the Lord is carrying your burdens. Psalm 55:22, cast thy burden upon the Lord, and he will sustain you. Okay. When you give your life, your burdens, your worries, fears, temptations, trials, you give them to the Lord, then he'll sustain you. He'll bear you up as on eagle's wings. And you'll run and not be weary, and you'll walk and not faint. You shall renew your strength. Now it says Moses was as strong the day he died, and that was at 120, as he was when he was 40. He still had his proper vision at 120. Imagine that. Not many of us could say that even after 40. My case, around 17, my vision started to fade. But at any rate, they shall run and not be weary, they shall walk and not faint. Running the Christian life. See, sometimes you may get tired. You might think, wow, it takes a lot of strength to do this. Well, it depends on who you're doing it for. If you're just doing it to be seen of men, then yeah, you're going to run out of gas. But if you're doing it for the Lord, then he's going to continually strengthen you. Right? It's just the way it is. He's a well of water, bread of life, living water. There's no end of resources of strength with the Lord. You'll be able to run the Christian life. You'll be able to endure persecutions and afflictions. Psalm 103 and verse 12 says, as far as the east is from the west, so far hath he removed our transgressions from us. Now that's good news. And you can build your life upon that, knowing that your sins have been forgiven. That's the best news you could ever hear. That should encourage you to run the Christian life, to keep pressing on. That takes an enormous burden off your back, doesn't it? When you know your sins have been forgiven, I mean, cast from you as far as the east is from the west, well, the east does never meet the west. Like as a father pitieth his children, so the Lord pitieth them that fear him. When you fear God, God pities you. He has mercy upon you. He knows you're not going to be perfect, but he sees you're trying to excel. You're trying to move in the right direction, to get where you need to be, sanctified and holy. Well, it takes years. Some sins don't just drop off that easily. You want to hang on, like an old filthy garment. Just doesn't seem to want to get off. Children of Israel walked around in the same pair of shoes for 40 years, same clothes. They couldn't shake it, you know, because they were living in sin. But the moment the children, their children, the next generation, entered in under Joshua's command in the Promised Land, guess what? All that old clothes came off. They entered into the Promised Land, new land, land of obedience and blessing, floweth the milk and honey. The blessing of the Lord maketh rich, and he hath no sorrow to him. And he knoweth our frame, he remembereth that we are dust. God has mercy upon us. He pities us because we fear him. Job. I'd like to turn our attention next to Job. In chapter 17 and verse 9, the righteous also shall hold on his way, and he that hath clean hands shall be stronger and stronger. The purity of heart, purity of life, will make you strong. Okay? It will strengthen you physically and spiritually. First spiritually and then physically. The stronger you are spiritually, the more sanctified your life is, and God is going to keep you strong, even physically. Granted, there will come a day when your strength will run out, no matter how godly you are, and you will die. I will die, unless the Lord comes first. Nobody knows. But before we reach that point, the Word of God says that he who hath clean hands shall be stronger and stronger. So, the more pure, the more sanctified our lives are, the more God strengthens us to carry on. And that's good news. That's encouraging. It should want to make us live holy. Now, finally, Job 23 and verse 10, I'm going to close. I know it's getting dark. Probably have to turn that light on. 23 and verse 10. But he knoweth the way that I take, and when he hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold. I'll go ahead and turn the light on. Hopefully that helps a little bit. But there it says that he knoweth the way that I take. And when he hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold. There's a lot in that verse, Job 23:10. First of all, God knows our way that we take. We don't understand it always. Sometimes we catch a glimpse of why we're going through the things we go through. So at other times, can't even understand it until we get out of it. So, now I see why. See why, what God was trying to teach me. That's what we need to learn. We need to be learning. Things don't just happen out of coincidence. Things happen for a reason in God's world. There's no such thing as luck. No such thing as chance. Why? Because God is sovereign. God is sovereign, that eliminates luck and chance. Everything happens for a reason. We need to identify the reason, the cause. Things are good, blessings in our life. Other things, not so good. We need to identify why. I see why on some things. Other things, I'm still a little uncertain. But God will reveal in time. For He knoweth the way that I take. And when He hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold. That's a guarantee for you and for me. He's going to try us. We're going to be put through the furnace of affliction. There's no getting out of it. It happens to all of His children. But the good news is, we're going to come forth as gold. Yeah, it's going to hurt. We're going to get burned. When the heat is turned up, and the impurities have to be melted out, burned out, God does that through trials and afflictions, persecutions, temptations. We've got to burn them out. And God has to burn them out. We have to submit to Him, to His Lordship. And when we do that, when we relinquish the control over our lives, then God gets the victory. He gets what He wanted to get out of us. And we become more like Christ, yielding to the sovereign hand of God, yielding to the authority of God. That's what God wants. That's what He expects of us, to yield to His authority over our lives. Where is His authority? How do we know His authority? Well, it's right here. It's in the Word of God. Be sanctified. Don't give that which is holy unto the dogs. Don't cast your pearls before the swine. You do those things, they'll render them under their feet and they'll turn and rend you. There is an answer for every problem, situation, life found in God's Word. Now, it may be a principle that you have to build off of for your particular situation, but the principles are there in God's Word. I guarantee you that. For every situation in your life, the principle can be found in God's Word of how to deal with it. You don't know that, then you're not reading your Bible enough. Okay. We can learn a lot out of the Old and the New Testament. I think we can learn more out of the Old just because all the stories and incidents of the great men and women of the Bible, see how they walked, see what happened when they disobeyed, see what happened when they obeyed. New Testament, I don't see a whole lot of that, the stories and stuff. You just see, you know, the Gospels and the letters written by Paul, Peter, and James, Jude, the others. But, yes, we see the life of Paul. We see Paul laboring for the Lord. Hear Peter preaching about, you know, living a godly life, James, John. But the stories are found in the Old Testament. Stories, the life of David, the life of Jacob, the life of Joseph, the life of Elijah, Elisha, Jonah, all these great men, Deborah, and women too, in the Bible, Sarah, you know, Adam and Eve. We see what happens when they obey, when they disobey. Children of Israel wandered for 40 years, couldn't get in to the good land, stuck in the desert. So it's trusting in the Lord, drawing strength from Him, and relinquishing our lives into His hands. Letting Him have the control, full control. Letting go of those old habits. We're new. We've been forgiven. We're a new creature, new creation in Christ. We don't need to go back to that old stuff. Okay. So I'm going to close with a word of prayer, and then we'll be finished. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You and praise You for Your goodness, grace, love, and mercy, for all that You've done, all that You are, and all that You continue to do in our hearts and our lives. And Lord, we thank You for the truths of Your Word, the lessons today found in Job 17, 23, and Psalm 103, and Lord, Your Word is just in Isaiah 40, chapter 40 as well. It is an instruction for us, a lamp to our feet, a light unto our path. God, we pray that we will be waiting on You always, being patient, and drawing our strength and power from You in times of temptation and trial, not caving in, not going back to our old ways. God, grant us the grace and strength to relinquish our lives over to You. In the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ, You be glorified.